Welcome back to everyone to this third session entitled Control of the Bacterium in the Host Plants. My name is Blanca Landa and I work at the Institute for Sustainable Agriculture that belongs to the Spanish National Research Agency in Spain. I will co-chair the session with Pasquale Saldarelli that you know from yesterday's session. He works at the Institute for Sustainable Plant Protection at CNR in Bari. So I will introduce the first two speakers, and Pasquale will introduce the next two ones. So I'm in charge of Work Package 6 of X Factors. This work package deals with the development of innovative and sustainable approaches for bacterial control in the host plant. Within this huge work package, we have different activities. I will just refer to a few of them, and Pasquale will refer also to the one remaining. So one of the objectives of this work package is to develop or to select different innovative tools for bacterial control, but focusing on the plant, on the host. And these innovative tools include signaling compounds, antimicrobial peptides, bacteriophage, and also with the aim of integrating them with the different environmental and economically suitable strategies, such as exploiting the plant natural biodiversity, looking for host resistance, and also to share and to provide insight in the plant microbial diversity that is within the host plant. The plant microbiome, as you know, nowadays is one of the main research focus, since it is well known that it has an important role on developing resistance or in the resistance and tolerance that the plants show against the pathogens. So today we will listen about some of the activities they develop in these four packages. Some of them are related to the search for new bacteriophage. As you know, bacteriophage are some interesting biocontrol agents for Xylella fastidiosa because they are non-toxic and they are normally very specific. We made very strong efforts to share for bacteriophage against Xylella fastidiosa, and at the end we were lucky to be able to isolate them, and we will listen what was the process, this long process during the project. Other important objective in this work package was to develop and select different antimicrobial peptides against Xylella fastidiosa. As you know, these antimicrobial peptides are polypeptides that are components of the innate immune system in the animals, plants, and microorganisms. And they play an important role in antagonistic relationships among the different microorganisms. So the work was focused on analyzing and synthesizing synthetic antimicrobial peptides that could have increased antimicrobial activity against Xylella and that were more stable and could be applied directly on the plant. You can see some of these results in the different posters, so please have a look to them. And then another important activity within this work package was to analyze and exploit the olive xylem microbiome, trying to look for a prophylactic or therapeutic treatment for Xylella fastidiosa control in the plant. As you know, and as I told you, the microbiome has gained importance during the last year. So it was a big effort to analyze and to compare what are the factors that shape the xylem microbiome, if we can isolate these indigenous bacterial or fungal inhabitants of the xylem vessels, if we can culture them, and what is more important, if we can treat the plants and look for a specific antagonist of Xylella. And you will listen to one of the other presentations dealing with this subject, but also please have a look to the different and several posters that are present in the conference, in the X Factor or the EFSA conference, because some of them are very, very interesting. So now we'll give the floor to my colleague, Pasquale, if you want to also to mention some of the results of the other activities within the World Package.
Thank you, Blanca, and good afternoon to everybody. As Blanca anticipated, World Package 6 is a very hot topic because it deals with curing, try to cure infected plants, and also with in a sustainable way. You will have a couple of examples of these experiments, of these essays in X Factors. These will be the two presentations that I will chair. One from Carmine Del Grosso and dealing with natural compounds, and the other from Valeria Scala dealing with trying to change, to interfere with the behavior of the pathogen of the Xylella. But you also already had in the first session some example of this. I'm referring to the diffusible signaling factors that was presented in the first days, and which is also a subject of the Work Package 6. Other activities that X Factors stimulated was, and I invited you, as Blanca did, to check the posters, are those related to the use of ammonium quaternary, or also another hot topic, which is the use of nanoformulation of zinc and copper. But you can have also posters dealing with natural products. There is a company screening platform for biofilm inhibition, and these natural compounds. I invite you to follow this session, and also to check the poster. That's all for me.
Okay, so we will start now with the first speaker, Maria Domingo Calab, that will present the isolation and characterization of bacteriophage against Xylella fastidiosa. Maria works at the empresa de transformación agraria Traxa in Spain, and also at the Centro de Protección Vegetal y Biotecnología at the Instituto Valenciano de Investigaciones Agrarias in Valencia, Spain. So, Maria?
Hello.
Okay, so we will tell you when you have 2 minutes left. So please keep on time, because we are a little bit delayed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Blanca and Pasquale, for your introduction. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to present here part of the work that we are developing in the laboratory of Esther Marco in the IBIA, in the framework of the project XF Actors. And I'm going to talk about the isolation and characterization of bacteriophage against Xylella fastidiosa. That is a part of the task 6.3 of the Work Package 6. As you know, Xylella fastidiosa is an important bacteria worldwide. And in Europe, there are different outbreaks, most of them located in the Mediterranean basin. And in Spain, we have 2 active outbreaks, one in the Balearic Islands and other in Alicante. And to control this pathogen, the measures that are being applied are focused on the vector control and in the eradication of the infected plants. But these measures are insufficient, so that it is necessary to develop new control strategies. In our laboratory, we are interested in the search of specific bacteriophages against Xylella fastidiosa, particularly against European isolates. Phages are a natural predator of bacteria, are the most abundant biological entities in the biosphere. In fact, there are at least 10 times more than phages and bacteria. They are highly variable and they can present a biological cycle, lytic or lysogenic, and we are interested in the lytic ones. Phages can be used in biomedicine or agronomy for disease treatment, but also for prevention and even for bacterial detection and typing. The advantages of phage therapies are very clear compared to the use of antibiotics. For example, phages are more specific and can counteract the resistance. And I saw here an example where a phage cocktail was used to treat a girl with a resistant Mycobacterium abscessus. There are also cocktails commercialized of phage for therapy, for example, Phacobarn to treat Escherichia coli and Pseudomonas aeruginosa, and also PhageWard to treat Listeria species. In agronomy, different biocontrol experiments have been reported using phages to treat bacterial diseases, for example, a cocktail to treat peace disease in California. Our objective is to isolate specific phages against Lila fastidiosa with a focus in European isolates of the pathogen. For that, we assay the double technique, the double layer technique, but with the fastidious and slow growth of the bacteria Xylella fastidiosa, we decide to use Xanthomonas species as roid host. We use the strain IBIA131718 of Xanthomonas arboricola patobarjuglandis, CHAG, which is a pathogen of Wellnose trees, and the strain CCT914 of Xanthomonas axonopodis pathobar faseoli, CHAP, which is a pathogen of wheat. Then we test different vegetal samples infected by Xanthomonas, and also we use blood samples infected by Xylella fastidiosa from Balearic Island and Alicante outbreaks, as well as soil samples and reverse water samples. But we were unsuccessful in finding phages in these cases. For this reason, we contact Pilar Domingo. She is the leader group of the Environmental and Biomedical Viruses Lab in the University of Valencia, because she's a specialist in biomedical bacteriophages, and we decide to test different water samples from treatment plants from Valencia. We use four different samples from two treatment plants, and here you can see that we observe different plagues with different morphology against CHAG and against CHAP. For example, in this plate, we can observe different plagues with different morphologies. So that we select the different morphologies to isolate the phages, and we isolate a total of 22 bacteriophages, 14 for CHAG, and 8 for CHAP. Here you can see the 14 phages isolated using CHAG. As you can see, we can observe different plagues with different morphology. And here you can see the 8 phages isolated using CHAG. To amplify the bacteriophages, on one hand, we use as control the only bacteria and the isolated phage, and then we grow the phage with the bacteria. Then we plate the samples, and as you can see, if we see the same dilution, we can observe in the amplified one more PFUs than in the not amplified, confirming the amplification of the phage. We amplify the 22 phages, and here you can see the spot test of the 14 phages isolated using CHAG at different time points. And here you can see the spot test using the 8 phages isolated using CHAG at different dilutions. Then with these 22 isolated phages, we perform spot test using different species of Xanthomonas, different strains, and here you can see the table with all the strains that we use. In green, you can see the strains susceptible to viral infection. We also test other pathogenic bacteria of different genera than Xanthomonas, for example, Agrobacterium, Pseudomonas, Erbinia, But in any of these cases, we observe lytic activity of any of the isolated phages. Here I show you a representative table with different strains of Xanthomonas. In yellow, here you can see the 14 phages isolated using CHAF, and here you can see the 8 phages isolated using CHAF. And in green, you can see the phages with lytic activity for the different strains of Xanthomonas. As you can see, we observe phages with narrow range, for example, the phage P12. And also we observe phages with broad range, such as P10.2. It's interesting that with the 8 phages isolated using CHAP, we didn't observe lytic activity in any of the Xanthomonas strains used. Then we move to the experiments using Shigella fastidiosa. We start using the strain EVIA-5901, which is a Shigella fastidiosa subspecies multiplex, isolated from Almond in Alicante, and the strain EVIA-5770, which is a Shigella fastidiosa subspecies fastidiosa, isolated from Grapevine in Mallorca. Here I show you the results of the 22 isolated phages using the strain EVIA-5901. And you can see in black the normal growth of the bacteria and in color the growth of the bacteria plus the phage. In orange, you can observe the phages isolated using CHAF, and in green, the phages isolated using CHAF. In most cases, there is a reduction in growth of the strain, but it was not significant. In contrast, when we use the strain EVIA-5770, here you can see the same scheme. In black, you can see the growth of the only bacteria, and in color, the bacteria plus the phage. In this case, we observe that some of the phages reduce the bacteria growth significantly, even until zero. For this reason, we decide to test different strains of Shigella fastidiosa superspecies fastidiosa, and we select the strain Temecula 1, which is an USA strain, and then we select 5 different strains from Spain. Here you can see the 22 isolated phages tested with Temecula 1, and in any case, we observe lytic activity. However, with the 5 strains from Spain, we observe lytic activity, and I'm going to present you some of the results that we obtain. Here, for example, I show you a phage without activity, such as P1, and also a phage with activity, such as P19. In the case of P1, we can observe in black the normal growth of the bacteria, and in orange, the growth of the bacteria plus the phage. As you can see, we did observe a drastic reduction of the growth of the bacteria in the presence of the phage. In contrast, if we focus on the phage P19, we observe in black the normal growth of the bacteria, and in green, the growth of the bacteria plus the phage. And as you can see, the phage reduced the bacteria growth even until zero. Okay, here I'm going to show you the activity of the phage P13. I'm going to show you 3 different strains of Shigella fastidiosa subspecies fastidiosa, EVIA-5235, EVIA-5770, and EVIA-5772. In black also you can see the normal growth of the bacteria, and in orange the growth of the bacteria in presence of the phage. Regarding the previous slide where I showed you the amplification of the phages, here you can see that when we grow only the phage and we compare with the phage, the bacterial growth with the phage, we observe an amplification of the phage, suggesting that the reduction that we observe in the growth of the bacteria is due to the activity of the phage. And here also you can see an image of the morphology of the phage P13. Then we purify and sequence the 22 phages, and now we are working on the genomic characterization. And I'm going to present you the genomic characterization of the phage P15, P18, P19, and P21. Here you can see the genomic annotation, and we focus on the DNA polymerase and the coprotein to perform a neighbor 3. And all these data suggest us that these four viruses belong to the Sectivididae family and to the Apatectivirus genus. Then we move to the electron transmission microscopy, and the viral particles of this genus of virus are icosahedrons of approximately 60 to 70 nanometers. And you can see here images under the electron transmission microscopy, and all the virion particles are the typical of this genus of virus, Apatectivididae. And just before finishing, here is a summary. We isolated 22 bacteriophages from wastewater samples. We amplified these phages and tested them in different Chantomonas species and other non-Chantomonas phytopathogenic bacteria. And also we tested them in different strains of Shigella fastidiosa. But we are continuing testing these phages with more Shigella fastidiosa strains. Then we perform phage purification and phage sequencing, and we are working on genome assembly, genome annotation, and genomic characterization, and also in electron microscopy. And to finish, I would like to thank Esther Marco and her team, of which I am a member, and also Pilar Domingo. And thank you all for your attention.
Massimiliano Morelli, he also works at the Institute for Sustainable Plant Protection in Bari. Massimiliano will present how to explore endophytic microbial communities to identify potential biocontrol agents against Shigella fastidiosa, and specifically against strain de Dono, that is the one present in Italy. So, Massimiliano, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Good afternoon to everybody, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to present my contribute. In this talk, I will report a collective effort from a long list of colleagues, and I should say also a multi-year effort. Why this study? You may have learned from the previous talks, or in general from the literature, that huge effort has been done to characterize genetic, genomic, or biological features of Xylella fastidiosa interaction with its host. However, despite growing evidences are supporting the theory that changes in microbial communities may drive disease susceptibility, this aspect has been not widely studied in relation to Xylella fastidiosa associated disease. That's why we started our study, which aims to investigate changes in the olive xylem microbiome associated to Xylella fastidiosa infection, as to assess correlation between microbiome and responses to Xylella fastidiosa infection, in particular with reference to resistant and susceptible olive cultivars. And moving forward to identify microorganisms that could be associated to the resistant phenotypes, and thus leading to identify potential biocontrol agents. To this aim, we started the microbiome study and selected a field which was located in the Apulian outbreak, and where susceptible and resistant cultivars coexisted. We collected our samples from six olive trees belonging to the susceptible cultivar Calamata, and from six olive trees from the cultivar FS17, which had shown promising traits of resistance. These trees share the same age, about 15 years old, and were subjected to the same management practices. As for Xylella infection, at the first time point of our experiment, which was set in spring 2017, we could detect by PCR low or no Xylella fastidiosa infection, But when time over time this disease increased, and in the second time point in autumn 2018, it was possible to detect Xylella fastidiosa population levels in both cultivars. With regards to symptoms, they progressed accordingly to the infection. And as you can see in the picture, in November 2018, Kalamata showed manifest desiccation, whereas in the lower part, FS17 was still showing very mild or not symptoms at all. Since this study was done in tandem between CNR in Bari and our colleagues from Bragança and Portugal, we decided to make a combined effort relying on two different sequencing approaches. To this same DNA extracted from xylem shavings was subjected to a library preparation with a PCR-free Illumina kit in the first case, which before sequencing with a non-targeted method, the whole metagenome shotgun sequencing, or WMSS. In the second case, the same DNA was amplified with the primers designed in the V3V4 region of the 16-hex rRNA gene in the case of bacteria, or amplified in the ITS1 region in the case of fungi prior to Illumina sequencing. Why this dual approach? Okay. Why this dual approach? Because we want to merge and combine the pros and cons coming from the two different techniques, because of course we were expecting increased the sequencing depth in the first case, leading to higher data recovery, but this is also a most expensive method and that could rely on less established protocols. Whereas in the second case, we could rely on more consolidated pipelines. This is, of course, a more cost-effective method, but conversely, this analysis is based only on one single gene. What I was saying that once our bioinformaticians could optimize the pipeline, mainly avoiding specific matches with plant genome, plant plastidial genome or blue-green algae, we could get very satisfactory results with both techniques, leading us to identify these taxonomical ranks, and including the bacteria and fungi for both methods. And we also retrieved viral sequences in WMSS, as well as archaea, three archaea phyla were identified with this method. And also these extremophiles have a role that has not been so far elucidated. This was interesting to comment. Besides the general description of the microbiome, it was relevant for us to try to identify which could be biological parameters able to drive microbial changes. And here you see summarized the three parameters that we selected. Season, as I told you, sampling was done in spring 2017 versus autumn 2018. Cultivar, as I mentioned, we had resistant FS17 versus susceptible Kalamata, and we also included the Xylella fastidiosa relative abundance expressed in terms of Xylella reads over total bacterial reads and setting the threshold to 5%. By this way, we could conclude that season was the main factor shaping microbial communities. And as you see from WMSS data in bacteria, when we perform a principal component analysis followed by ANOSIM statistical validation, we could clearly separate the olive sampled in spring 2017 from those sampled in autumn 2018. And this significant significant trend of separation was also confirmed relative to fungi. These data were also confirmed when we checked data from 16-hex rRNA ITS sequencing, And as you can see, the plotting following non-metric multidimensional scaling followed by ANOSIM statistical validation clearly confirmed that bacterial and fungal communities could be significantly separated according to the season of sampling. We also performed the PERMANOVA analysis, which allowed us, when considering total variation, to explain that this percentage of total variation could be mainly explained by season and followed by Xylella fastidiosa abundance. With regards to Xylella abundance, we could find that Xylella tended to occupy the whole xylem niche, and this negatively impacted the bacterial community. We measured in WMSS that Xylella represented more than 70% of the whole bacterial microbiome. Indeed, we could not identify any significant cultivar effect. However, it's worth it to mention that if we refer back to the ratio which I was showing before, like Xylella over bacterial reeds, this number was significantly increasing over time from spring to autumn. And notably, this was more evident in Kalamata, thus leading us to hypothesize that FS17 is somehow more resilient to Xylella infection. And this could be confirmed also by qPCR analysis. Here you see that estimated population size was varying and increasing from spring to autumn, but these changes were significant only in Kalamata and not in FS17. It's interesting that also when we measure microbial diversity expressed in terms of Shannon alpha diversity, which by the way takes into account not only number of species, but also which is richness, but also their relative abundance, the so-called evenness, we could measure that FS17 had higher diversity in both bacteria, fungi, but also archaea. And this was another indirect proof that led us to hypothesize that this cultivar may be less prone to changes induced by Xylella fastidiosa infection. This analysis also confirmed what I was mentioning before, and alpha diversity was higher in spring 2017 and in presence of low Xylella fastidiosa infection. These were main findings from the first part of our study, but we had in mind also to investigate other potential application. That's why we started a second part of the study, which was led by our colleagues from CNR Institute of Science of Food Production in Bari, which was aimed to isolate, characterize, and identify culturable bacterial xylem endophytes from Holly in the Xylella fastidiosa affected area, and to evaluate their antagonistic activity against Xylella fastidiosa strain, the Donna. And moving forward, we also include in this study some strains belonging to the genus, Bacillus genus, as they had been described several times as to possess, to produce antimicrobial substances. And in many cases, they were also proposed and used effectively as biocontrol agents, also against plant pathogens. To the aim of this study and in line with the previous study, we refer to the same field, in many cases to the same trees, but we also included in this case another resistant cultivar, Leccino, together with FS17, whereas the susceptible Kalamata, the susceptible cultivar remained Kalamata. We were aware to collect samples from trees which were symptomless or showing only scattering desiccation, as in case of Kalamata. And regarding the low infection levels, we could assess by qPCR plants which showed still an undetectable or low population size of bacteria. In our effort, a low number of culturable endophytic bacteria was isolated from olive xylem tissues. As you can see, we were able to find some genus which were more frequent in different cultivars. However, it was not possible to identify bacteria species which were specifically associated to one cultivar or correlated with the resistant phenotype or at least with the Xylella fastidiosa infection level, as it was in our best expectation. However, more than 100 isolates representative of the whole collection were tested in dual culture assays against Xylella fastidiosa strain Dedona, but unfortunately, none of them showed antagonistic activity. Sorry, but again, don't know why. Okay. Okay. When we made recourse to already isolated and characterized Bacillus strains, we got a very satisfactory result, as many strains, several strains, were showing a large inhibition halos, and most prominently, strains of Bacillus valenzensis, Bacillus amyloliquefaciens, showed the highest antagonistic activity, which was further proved to be a bactericidal effect. The most promising strain was also tested using the culture filtrates instead of pure culture. And also in this case, we could observe inhibitory activity against Xylella fastidiosa Dedona growth. And this effect was increasing over time of incubation. I should note that two of these strains had been already registered and as biocontrol agents and are commercially available. Time is running out, so I have just the last slide because all the time is stopping. Yeah, let me to conclude that these findings are very interesting because lay the groundwork for future investigation in several directions. And let me thank all the colleagues which conceived and were collaborating to this study, and funding from Ezio Control, Ponte, and X Factor Project, who, by the way, gave me the big chance to be part of this amazing scientific network. Thank you. Sorry for this inconvenience.
Okay, thank you, Massimiliano. So now it's time for questions. We will start with Maria Luisa. Okay. They asked you if there is some evidence that the phages actually grow and reproduce within the plant xylem in nature or in agricultural situations, not under lab conditions.
Until now we don't start experimenting planta, but considering that the phages can infect Xylella, any plant susceptible to be infected by Xylella, it will be susceptible to the phage infection.
Okay. Another question is that it is well known that plant pathogenic bacteria and other bacteria develop frequent resistance to bacteriophage by mutation in the cell envelope receptors in the lipopolysaccharides. So it is expected this problem with Xylella fastidiosa. They say, I think I saw some colonies inside the lysis plaques of your pictures that can be resistant colonies.
Yes, we observe some resistant, but for this reason, we are going to use phage cocktails to avoid the phage resistance.
Okay. Again, if you tested your phages on infected plants, it's obvious that not because you were able to isolate the phages at the end of the project. Also, they asked you if you tried or planned to collect bacteriophages in areas where Xylella fastidiosa is endemic, for instance, in the Americas. And maybe they said that probably the spectrum of phages can be higher there.
It could be interesting, but before we have a lot of sources in Spain to test to isolate phages, but it could be in a future. Yes, a good point.
Okay, so One question is that it was not clear if you evaluate the phage activity against Xylella only in liquid medium or also by plague assay.
Xylella only in liquid media because due to the fastidious and slow growth in media, it was impossible to do, for example, spot tests to observe plagues.
Okay. So now there is some question for Massimiliano. I think this question is always made in every congress that we have. If you can explain, how do you explain the silent shavings?
Yes, with the xylem shavings, it was intended that we collected the twigs. We then cut them in small pieces, and we proceed with the surface sterilization. And then, in a sterility condition, we debark them, like eliminating the external part and trying to be as much as we could close to the xylem tissues, and we produce with we produce very small slices of tissue that were then macerated and processed accordingly. I should say that this was the same procedure for both studies, like for getting DNA extracts in the sequence, the microbiome study, but also to get culturable fraction for the second study.
Okay. So I have a question for you. I was really happy to see that in Spain we have similar results when we explore the silent microbiome of olive plants. That the main driver of the changes on the community composition, even either for bacteria or fungi, is the seasonality. So the biggest variation occurs during the year. I also, we found the same bacterial genera, but why did you were focusing only on looking for antibiotic activity? Because in the dual plate set that you developed, you were only looking for bacteria that produce different antimicrobial compounds. Why?
Excuse me, no, I didn't catch the question. Yeah.
You, for your search of looking for potential biocontrol agents, you only use the antagonistic activity on dual culture. So with this dual culture, you only look for antibiosis or the production of antimicrobial compounds. So what happens if maybe some of the bacteria can be very good competitors of the xylem niche? You are not looking for other factors or other potential elements.
Yes, this in our mind was the first large preliminary screening, and then if we could also find other efforts, this would have been the second, the future direction, one of the future directions that we could investigate, because it was at the beginning preliminary effort to get screening, because as you well know, we also didn't have any literature on it, and this was also interesting for the part of characterization of this microbe. However, you can find you like the audience can find better details also on their characterization in the paper which has been published at Zika et al.
And concerning the commercial products, the bacillus that you mentioned at the end that the were showing, I guess, antimicrobial activity. Have you started, or do you plan to do experiments already on the plant?
We didn't start in this study, but of course this will be the expectation for future application in plant, because we also should test the colonization attitude, the attitude to colonize xylem vessels of these strains to go beside the in vitro behavior.
I have also a question for Maria Luisa. Why do you think, what is the reason of not isolating phages from the infected areas in Spain? Because I know that other partners in the project did also the same experiments in Italy, and they also failed isolating phages from infected plant infected by Xylella fastidiosa. Do you know what can be the reason?
Maybe we have a problem of phage concentration in the samples, or we didn't treat correctly the samples. Maybe reasons to didn't find phages in these sources.
May I comment on this? Just a continuation of your question, Maria. So do you think if you have tested, tried to enrich your phage initially with Xylella, it would be beneficial or not for your selection, instead of using the surrogate strain?
Yes, it could be a good option to ensure that the phages that you are going to find are related to infection to Xylella fastidiosa. Maybe we are going to do some experiments to search more phages. We have in mind this enrichment with Xylella fastidiosa previously the search. Yeah.
So we will move to the second part of this session, and I invite Carmine Del Grosso. Carmine is a PhD student from the Department of Agricultural, Environmental and Food Sciences from the University of Molise. He had some experiences in our laboratory, but also in the laboratory of Marie in France. And he will speak about the evaluation of natural and eco-friendly compound for the antimicrobial activity against Xylella.
Thank you, Pasquale, for your introduction. You can hear me?
Yes, perfectly.
Perfect, thank you. Well, I can start. Non-pathogen bacteria control strategies are mainly preventive measures like quarantine, eradication, and sanitation. The traditional plant pathogenic bacterial control is based on copper products and other chemicals and antibiotics banned in agriculture in the European Union. We can see that we have we don't have many compound products approved against bacteria. In particular, you can see in the table that from the UA pesticide database that there is only 4 approved active substances that have a bactericide activity. For this purpose, we have to find other compounds and to test other compounds for their activity against bacteria, and in particular against Xylella, that is very difficult to contract. The modern trend of plant pathogenic bacterial control are biological control in sensu strictum that provide the use of antagonists or biocontrol agents, and biological control in sensu lato that provide the use of natural compounds, plant-derived and microbial-derived compounds, resistance inductors, biological soil improver, biofertilizer, and the biological activators. But the search is for an integrated approach for the management of bacteria. It is interesting. So the strategy for control Xylella fastidiosa, tested for control Xylella fastidiosa is to evaluate and set up a sustainable approach to counteract the bacterium on the plants. In particular, we evaluated the antimicrobial activity of some natural and eco-friendly compounds, the antimicrobial activity against different strains of Xylella fastidiosa, and the capability of the selected compounds to reduce the symptoms and the pathogenic lesions on river plants. In the table, we can see the product that we use in the study. We use a sea wood and polyphenol water extract and ethanolic extract, 5 polyphenolic bimolegles derived from woody plants, and a complex of silicon and microelements, includes zinc, a complex of ketosan and microelements, a zinc formulates that are systemic, and copper formulates also systemic, and a mixture of the two formulates. The approach that we use for testing the antimicrobial activity were assessed on the on some on some phytopathogenic bacteria use the disk diffusion assay method. We start from the you can see in the pictures at left. We start at the center of the plane. We put a positive control. We use an antibiotic reference. And we start from the lower concentration, the higher concentration to the lower concentration, and for positive control is the negative control. Sorry, we use the solvent that used for suspending the product. Sometimes water, and for some product we use ethanol. This is some pictures of the experiments conducted against Xylella fastidiosa pauca, Sterine ST53. And we can see that there is some inhibition halo around the disk, and also for the control, net positive and negative control. The results of this experience were reported in this graph. We can see where is reported the inhibition halo diameters in millimeters, and all the concentration tested against the bacteria, and also the fourth strain of Xylella tested. We use Xylella fastidiosa pauca ST53, Xylella fastidiosa strain CO33, and Xylella multiplex TOS1, and Xylella multiplex ASPL. As positive and negative control, we use the drug reference and the solvent used for suspending the product. We can see that in these compounds, ceaweeds and the polyphenol extract, are effective against ST, the strain FT53, and TOS1 and ASVL, but it's not, there is no activity against CO33. For the ethanolic extract, we can see that there is a higher activity against all the strain of Xylella. We have also tested the five polyphenolic compounds, the molecules, and we can see that in particular the polyphenolic molecules number one is have a very, very strong activity, in particular against the first three strains, ST53, CO33, and TOS1. You can see that is inhibited at the concentration of 0.5. But is also for ASVL is a good activity. The polyphenolic biomolecule number two, we can see that is have a good activity against the strain ST53 and the CO33, and less activity against TOS1 and ASVL. For the other polyphenolic biomolecules, we have the polyphenolic biomolecules number three that have a good activity against the strain of Xylella ST53 and lower against the other strain. But the concentration is, we can think that the use of these compounds in the field is the concentration used in the field is around the 1%, and we can see that also for TOS1 there is an inhibition at 1% and at high concentration for the other two strains. The polyphenolic biomolecules number four has effective against ST53, not have no activity against CO33, and a lower activity against the other two strains. For polyphenolic biomolecules number five, we have no activity against the three strain just for the strain of pauca, ST53, we can see just a little activity at the higher concentration. We have tested the silicon complex that have some microelements inside it, and also a lower zinc concentration. And we can see that there is no activity against the two strain of the subspecies multiplex, but again, ST53, there is a good activity at 4%, and it is interesting that on CO33, there is a good activity, but is not also, there is no activity for the ketosan complex, and we come back to the CO33, you can see that we have a low activity, a good activity against this strain of the silicon complex, such as we can see the zinc formulates have a good activity against the same strain. This is interesting because all the two formulates, also for ketosan, also for silicon complex, have a lower concentration of zinc, and they work against this strain. For zinc formulate, we can see that there is an inhibition against ASVL under TOS1, and there is no inhibition against this ST53. We have repeated a lot of times these experiments, and the results are the same. ST53 show a high resistance to zinc. Also, we can see the same trend with when we mix the two formulates, zinc and copper formulates. We have an activity on CO33 and no activity against the other strain. In this mixture, we have a three part of zinc and one part of copper, and we can see that the reduction of the concentration of the zinc in front of the zinc formulate reduce the activity also again the SVL strain. For the copper formulate, we have an homogeneous activity. We can see that all the strains were inhibited at a different concentration for ST53 at 1% and for CO33 at 0.5%, and the other strain were inhibited. Well, for after this, thanks to this screen, we are able to find the minimum inhibitory concentration of all. Of all the strains, but we concentrate on the Xerella fastidiosa subspecies pauca. We can see that the PB1 and PB2 are the more effective. We can see that we have an inhibition at 0.5% of concentration. The MIC is the MIC is at 0.5, and at 1% we can see that I have the Seawood and polyphenol ethanolic extracts, the PB3, the polyphenol biomolecules number 3, and the copper formulates. For Seawood polyphenols, we can see that we have a MIC concentration at 2%, and this is interesting because this is the field dose, and for PB4, we have the same concentration. We also include this concentration were selected for the testing in the field and also in the greenhouse testing. And we can we add that these experiments also, we include in this experiment also the zinc formulates. For the experiments on the greenhouse pot grow olive plants, we have evaluated all these compounds against the against Xerella fastidiosa symptoms and the plant colonization. We inoculate the plants by grafting infected zions, all the zions were analyzed by qPCR to confirm the presence of the bacteria. And in the table, you can see the experimental design on a susceptible host, cultivar Oyarola. In particular, we have a negative control in inoculated and untreated plants, a positive control inoculated and untreated plants. After we have four polyphenolic extracts selected, we use these compounds by foliar spray by foliar treatments, and zinc, also for zinc and copper formulates, and for seaweed polyphenols, we use soil treatment of the mixture. One treatment is preventive and another is curative. One before the inoculation, another after the inoculation of the bacteria. After 12 months, we have evaluated in December 2020. The experience were started in December 2019. In December 2020, we have evaluated the disease severity using the disease index, and monitoring the bacterium inside the plant using qPCR. The results are summarized in this graph, where we can see the disease index at left, that were represented with the bar, and at right with the dot, we can see the concentration of the bacteria inside the plants. There is no difference between the treatment on the concentration of the bacteria, but we can see that there is some difference of disease severity on the between the treatment. In particular, we can see that PB1, PB2, and PB3 also for Z formulates have reduced the symptoms on the plants. We can see in these pictures the representative pictures of the experiments, and you can see the difference on the positive control, that the plants are diet, the negative control, and also all the other treatments. We have PB, the most efficient treatment, PB1, PB2, PB3, and the zinc formulates. And we can see that the PB4 and the two formulates and the seaweeds treatments are not effective against the reduction of the symptoms. I go to the conclusion. We can in vitro all the tested compounds show an interesting and large spectrum antibacterial activity. Some of them were highly effective also against Salmonella fastidiosa, and many times more effective than the antibiotic-based reference drug that we use. We use a mixture of ampicillin and streptomycin. However, we have to investigate further aspects regarding the antimicrobial activity. And for the in vivo experiments, although we have no significant difference between the treatment on the concentration inside the plants detected by PCR, the treatment with PB1, PB2, PB3, and zinc were able to reduce temporarily the symptoms of Salmonella fastidiosa pauca. To this end, we must perform further experiments, also using a simplified patho system, for example, using an ergaceous host that is more easily to manageable than the olive trees. I think that I go very faster. Thank you for your attention, and I have to thank all the my co-authors, and also the research team of the plant pathology of the laboratory, the plant pathology laboratory of the University of Molise, and we are grateful to Donato Maria and the co-workers from the research team of EPSP CNR of Bari for their support and scientific cooperation. The research were supported by the XF Factors project, and also were partially supported from the MIPAF project Olivixit. Thank you.
From Valeria Scala, I invite Valeria Scala. Valeria belongs to the CREA, is the Council for Agricultural Economy Analysis, and particularly she belongs to the to the Department of Plant Defense and Crop Protection in Rome. The title of the presentation of Valeria is Signals in Pathogen and Loss Sensing, Free Fatty Acid and Oxylipin. Please, Valeria.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Pasquale. Good afternoon, I'm Valeria, and I describe you the results that we obtain in this research study that start thanks to X-Factor project 4 years ago. So I describe you signals in pathogen and host sensing, free fatty acid and oxylipin. Everybody knows the importance of lipids that are constituent of prokaryotic and eukaryotic membranes, and the ratio of saturated and unsaturated fatty acid contribute to membrane fluidity. Moreover, you know that plants, fungi, and bacteria contain a diverse set of lipids, and lipid metabolism is upregulated after pathogen infection. I'd like to highlight that lipids are a signal in stress response. The most information that we have in literature is related to oxylipins in eukaryotes. In eukaryotes, oxylipins respond to environmental factor, and we have different oxylipins produced by different enzymes. I remember you lipoxygenase or cyclooxygenase that are important to produce signals to activate the programmed cell death, or are factors for the susceptibility or resistance interaction among plant and fungi. Moreover, oxylipins are an important signal for the crosstalk. Perhaps I remember you that in fungal pathogen, perhaps fungal oxylipins can inhibit the production of oxylipins by the host. Whereas the plant can mimic, can hitchhiking the pathogen oxylipins for the plant response. So the main important message that we have to remember is that oxylipins are a cross-species signal in plant and fungi interaction. Very recently, Keller and colleague describe a model, proposed a model of oxylipin in like an autocrine and paracrine activity in fungal. In particular, they demonstrate that fungal oxylipins are produced and secreted. So they, these oxylipins can be can have an autocrine activity to regulate the fungal cellular differentiation and trigger the developmental process. Moreover, can also have a paracrine activity when they are secreted, and this case can influence the neighboring organism, so plant or fungi that occupy the common niche. What we know regarding lipids in bacteria, we know that bacteria can remodel the membrane lipids when they have to survive in particular stress condition, and lipids can be hydrolyzed by enzyme to produce signals like phosphatidic acid and the most famous oxylipin, that is jasmonic acid. Moreover, in Agrobacterium tumefaciens, we know that the virulence is influenced by phosphatidylcholine, that is a complex lipid, and ornitholipids that are typical bacterial lipids are elicitors of plant immune response. If we have a look to the plant, we can also remember that the nine oxylipins that we can say that we named nine lipoxygenase, perhaps nine LOX, affect the Pseudomonas aeruginosa quorum sensing. If we focus attention on prokaryota oxylipins, we have to remember the recent paper published by Martinez and Campos that define oxylipins produced in the periplasma, and free fatty acid are the substrate for produced oxylipins by different enzymes like fungi, perhaps deoxygenase, lipoxygenase, or alpha deoxygenase. So in this slide, I show perhaps a very little part of the pathway, metabolic pathway, that can be activated in bacteria. But the most important information that I want to give you, that there are very few information about bacteria, and there are information regarding oxylipins produced by phytopathogenic bacteria. To make a very long story short, in these slides I want only to remember you the paper from Rapicavoli and colleague that describe in the complex host vector and Xylella fastidiosa interaction the role of lipopolysaccharides that has the ability to shield the pathogenic bacteria to the plant recognition and delay the initial plant recognition in the early stage of infection. That is very important because I also want to remember the role of DSF, that you know are free fatty acid, that Xylella fastidiosa can use to regulating the quorum sensing. So in Xylella we have a switch from adherent biofilm phase when there is a high DSF concentration, and can move in the dual state from low cell density dispersal phase to a nicer density adherent biofilm phase, using a modulation related to DSF. Martinez and colleague recently demonstrated another kind of quorum sensing system based on oxylipins. In fact, in Pseudomonas aeruginosa, in this paper, they demonstrated that oxylipins can inhibit the flagellum-driven motility and also upregulate the twitching motility related to type 4 pyrus and organization macrocolonies. And moreover, this kind of oxylipins that I show you in these slides can promote the bacterium ability to form biofilm in vitro in vivo and promote the virulence of in Drosophila and plant. So at the start of our activity in X-Factor, we have some open questions. Perhaps is the lipidomic profile of all Europea and Monday plant alterated after Xylella fastidiosa infection? And is pertinent the ODS quorum sensing also in Xylella fastidiosa like happens in Pseudomonas aeruginosa? And moreover, if oxylipins can modulate the Xylella fastidiosa motility and biofilming? First of all, we published a paper where we determine a tissue-specific lipidomic profile in the model plant Nicotiana tabacum in artificially infected with Xylella fastidiosa. In this paper, we demonstrate by untargeted and targeted lipidomic profile the modulation of lipids and oxylipins in the plant tissue. So we, after the study, we tried to propose a model that was unpublished. According to our idea, we have Xylella fastidiosa that produce free fatty acid that are a substrate of oxylipins and can use these oxylipins to modulate the twitching of biofilm formation. Moreover, we know that Xylella has a typical bacterial lipids, perhaps ornitholipids, that can be, as happens in Agrobacterium, elicitors of PT implants. And also, according to Nascimento publication, we know the activity of lipase is very important as a virulence factor and can interact with plants and own lipids to activate all the profile related to oxylipins. So we have the production infected tissue that can switch on the pathway related to Jasmonic pathway. This kind of model is to propose you the possibility that there is a network among plant and bacterial lipid entities that can regulate and modulate this kind of interaction, like happens in fungi, perhaps. And the next step was also to describe if something moves in olive tree affected by Xylella fastidiosa. So we like the model plant, we determine an untargeted profile of lipid entities in Xylella plus and Xylella minus olive plants, and we identify some lipids, perhaps triglycerides and diacylglycerides or oxylipins that are upregulated, upaccumulated in this, in the plant affected by Xylella. And we observe an accumulation of 9 LOX oxylipins. That is very important. One result that was very fascinating to underline is that there is an overlap between the lipidomic profile of all Europea and Nicotiana tabacum after the infection of Xylella. So we can identify some lipids as hallmarks of Xylella infection. After all our lipidomic analysis and in particular after the targeted lipidomic analysis, we select some lipid entities and oxylipins that we decided to test in vitro to see if there is an effect on bacteria planktonic growth and biofilm formation. As I show in these slides, we have that the nine oxylipins, named the nine LOX, in particular is the nine hydroperoxide, promote the biofilm formation in vitro. And the DOX oxylipins stimulate the planktonic growth and inhibit the biofilm formation. Moreover, we describe we suggest the oxylipins metabolism in Xylella fastidiosa subspecies pauca because we use a lipidomic approach to describe all the oxylipins that are produced in the cell of Xylella fastidiosa and are secreted in the liquid media. So in this picture, you can see the oxylipins that we analyzed and are show you in the black font, whereas in gray font, I can only suggest the production of these oxylipins. So according to our results, we can assume that different free fatty acid and oxylipins are involved in the switch of dual phase of Xylella fastidiosa and using the model proposed by Roper and colleague, we can suggest a gradient of DOX oxylipin and LOX oxylipins in Xylella fastidiosa in two phase of dispersal phase, we have a more accumulation of DOX oxylipins. Whereas in the adherent biofilm phase, there is an abundance production of LOX oxylipins. But there are some open questions, perhaps if Xylella can coordinate its behavior through DOX oxylipins to trigger a systemic invasion in the host, and if plant LOX oxylipins can also trigger the acquisition phase, so stimulate the biofilm formation vector acquisition. In conclusion, we can assume that lipids with particular attention to oxylipins can modulate the biofilm formation and are alterated in Xylella fastidiosa and host interaction. Regarding the work in progress, we are now studying an extensive data set on potential oxylipins factor in susceptible cultivar, and we are studying the surface adhesion factor related to cell mobility and biofilm. I'd like to thank you for your attention and to my colleague for collaborating to these studies and all the projects that give us the possibility to study this aspect in Xylella.
A first question for Carmine is how do you explain that copper alone inhibit the Xylella growth, but when mixed with zinc, it does not?
I don't know if I forgot to talk about this, but the mixture of the two formulates are at a different concentration. We use three parts of zinc and one part of copper. And when we use the copper or the zinc formulate, we use the concentration, the maximum concentration that we use for this activity. And also it's interesting that for the two formulate, it's possible if you remember in the when we test in vivo the zinc, we have more effective than Q against Xylella on the plants. It's possible that there are involved some mechanism of resistance of the plant because these products are also inducing resistance in plants.
Okay, thanks. From Michael Maxner. Oh no, sorry. Another question close related to this one. This is my question. What is the difference from between your zinc copper formulation and the one that is extensively promoted for curing Xylella?
For our formulates is the tested formulate is systemic. Is not is a systemic compound. Is a zinc phosphate. And with some other micro elements, it's not only zinc, it's a compound at a lower concentration of zinc.
Another question for Carmine. Considering that the conditions in vitro and in vivo experiment are so different, do you think that increasing some fold the amount used for the in vivo experiment might give better protection?
Yeah, you can hear me?
Yes.
Yes, okay. Well, I think that there is a big difference from in vitro and in vivo experiment, and but sometimes we have to consider that all these products can not have also a antimicrobial activity, but also other activity on the plants that can induce resistance or other mechanisms involved for counteracting Xylella inside the plant.
Okay. One more, Carmine, can you give some information on the origin of the polyphenolic molecules you are testing, especially the most effective in inhibiting the in vitro and protecting the plant?
I can give more information because there are experimental products and the company that give us this product, we have to searching with their permission for this. But I can tell you that this product is woody plant extract like tannin and other polyphenols.
A question for Valeria. My question for Valeria. So a couple one. Considering that oxylipin, as far as I understand, inhibit biofilm formation.
Yes,
that could be a problem because you know the DSF production tends to promote biofilm, and when Xylella is more motile, more planktonic, is more virulent.
The question is if oxylipins are in contrast with DSF, Pasquale?
As far as I know, if Xylella is more motile, is more planktonic, is more virulent.
Okay. Yes. I try to explain. DSF are free fatty acid. So are molecules different from oxylipins because oxylipins are produced in stress condition when there are the production of ROS, perhaps, because after the oxygenation of free fatty acid, you produce the bacteria and the plant produce oxylipins. So our idea is that when it's very stressed, the plant perhaps, and there is an environmental that is stressed by ROS production, maybe in a mixture of free fatty acid, some promote the production of oxylipins that in some case produce an inhibition of on activation of biofilm. So there is a kind of modulation or equilibrium, we can say, among oxylipins and free fatty acid that is determined by a stress condition or not. That is very well studied. I'm sorry that I always remember the fungi, but it's very new in bacteria and phytopathogenic bacteria. So perhaps this kind of molecules and this equilibrium in the mixture was well studied in other plant pathogens binomium. So it's for the first time in bacteria and plant. So it's always I suppose.
Okay, I don't see any other question for both of you. So I think, Blanca, we can close the session and move to the conclusion.
Maybe we can follow the order of the sessions. Yeah.
Okay, then I can start if you want. I start the conclusions on the topics related to the vector biology, and then maybe Alberto can summarize the contributions related to vector management.
Yes.
I think the talks today provided interesting new information about the different aspects of vector biology related to pathogen transmission. You heard about the astonishing diversity of vector species in olive groves in Brazil, which is so different from the situation in Europe. The influence of biotic and abiotic factors on vector feeding and pathogen transmission, and the ecological factors that drive the population dynamics of Phalaenus pumarius in the model area in Corsica. Of course, there were a large amount of further results that have been achieved by XF actors besides those presented today. But as I mentioned before, some are presented in the poster session and others have been or will be published in journals or in the deliverables of the project. Let me just point out a few topics that were where we made progress in XF actors, but which were not covered by the session today. These are, for example, comparative studies on the feeding behavior of infected and non-infected vectors, investigations on the genetic structure of spittlebug populations and their microbiome, or the research on the olfactory response of spittlebugs to plant volatiles. So I think the work carried out in the frame of XF actors contributed considerably to improve our understanding of the spittlebug vector's role in the disease epidemiology and also to create the basis for control methods against the vectors. The work is also, in my eyes, an important contribution to improve modeling as well as surveillance and the prevention of disease spread. That means that with XF actors, we did a major step forward in our knowledge of the biology of the European vectors of Xylella fastidiosa, which are so different from the vectors in the Americas. But of course, as always, new research questions arise from our enhanced knowledge. We have gained a lot of basic information on the principal vectors in Europe, their biology and their role in the disease spread. But in my eyes, an important task for future research should be a kind of fine-tuning. That means that we use the information and tools that we have now available to analyze the role of vectors in the pathosystem system more specifically. That means more specifically with respect to particular regional, agricultural, or pathogen traits. And therefore, I would like to mention a few points for future work, which is, of course, not complete. For example, the studies on the complex of conditional preferences in vector feeding with respect to climate, habitat, plant physiology, and plant infection status, or the Xylella subspecies would be very interesting and important, but also the continuation of the comparison of vector feeding properties on resistant versus susceptible cultivars. Although the vector-based surveillance tools and strategies and the testing should be tested for their practical suitability in different regions, and they could be used for in-depth analysis of regional or crop-specific pathosystems. It would also be necessary to investigate further the vector-mediated interrelationship between crop systems and the wild compartment with respect to the influence of seasonal vector dispersal or the movement and movement in regional context, of course, but also the alternative sources of infection or the role of asymptomatic acquisition hosts in the herbaceous vegetation for the vector infection. Also, I think the promising results achieved in this project on plant volatiles that could be attractant or deterrent to XF vectors justify the transfer of those experiments to the field. And finally, in addition to the investigations on the endosymbionts as potential limiting factors for vector populations, we should initiate studies on the potential use of antagonistic microorganisms or chemicals to intervene with Xylella acquisition, retention, or transmission by spittlebugs. However, Xylella AXF Actors is now ending as a project, and the questions or the answers to those questions must be left to future projects. So for me, it's only now to thank all the speakers of this session this afternoon and you for your attention. And so I will pass over to Alberto.
Hello, good evening, everybody. I think it has been a very successful session. And in some of the talks have covered the main aspects of control of vectors, but there are some other posters and some other topics that have not been covered in the four talks related with control of vectors that I would like to highlight. One of the major contributions of X factors is looking for solutions to control the vectors of Xylella fastidiosa. And in this respect, I would highlight the work done on mating disruption using vibrational signals. I think as these insects communicate very much using sounds, this is a very promising way to control the vector by disrupting their behavior, their mating disruption, and perhaps also their feeding, as we found today in the presentation made by Sabina. Also, I would like to highlight another aspect that is very promising, which is the using endosymbiotic bacteria, such as Wolbachia, as a biological tool for controlling Phyllenus spumarius. And in this respect, there is a poster on this aspect that is also interesting to look at. We haven't talked today very much about sticky traps, but there are several posters related to sticky traps, and this is another contribution of the project, that different methods for surveillance should be used, not only sampling with one of the techniques that has been proposed, such as sweep net, but also there might be important to use also sticky traps and other sampling methods. In relation with control tactics or control methods, we've seen that there are several approaches that can be used to reduce the population of juveniles. It has been clear now that by controlling the juveniles, we are focusing on the most vulnerable stage of the insect, because once they get into the adult stage, it's very difficult to control the transmission of the bacteria. Also, I would like to highlight the use of resistance cultivars, not only resistance to the bacteria, but there is also the possibility of developing cultivars that are resistant to the vector itself. And I think in this sense, also there has been some work being done. And in the future, I think there will be more work on the looking at resistant varieties, not only to the bacteria, but also to the vectors. As another important aspect, I think, is to look at different insecticides or molecules that could interfere with the transmission of the bacteria. In this sense, there has been also another important contribution of the project looking at insecticides. And also, it would be interesting to look at peptides that might be important to reduce the transmission or the retention of the bacteria in the vector. In the near future, I think there will be some important work coming in relation with peptides and antimicrobials for the control of not only the bacteria, but also the vector itself. I would like to also highlight the use of cultural strategies, cultural control strategies to manage the populations of Phyllenus, as it has been today presented by Enza and Giovanni, that by managing the ground covers using tillage or different cultural control strategies, we can manage the vectors in the juvenile stage, which is the most vulnerable. And I would also talk about migration. Migration is important, and this is not it has not been covered in the oral presentations, but there has been some other posters related with migration studies on vectors, which are also important to look at, because this will depend very much on the way they move, the way they can be controlled. And also it will be important for modeling the presence or the spread of the disease in certain places. And I would like to end up in my talk talking about biocontrol. There has been some efforts done on the control of these Phyllenus insects by using egg parasitoids. And I think this has a lot of future in the next coming years, because by reducing the number of Phyllenus spumarius using egg parasitoids, we will reduce the population. And this work that has been started in Corsica should be conducted also in some other places in Europe. I think those are the major aspects that have been focused in the work package 7. And I think this would be, which I would like to highlight to everybody and give the thanks to everybody working in this project, and also thanks to all the people attending the talk. Right now, I would tell Blanca to make a summary on the session on control of the bacteria.
Yeah. So we finished with the four presentations that were focusing on the control of the bacterium, but on the host plant. And we have the chance to see four different approaches, very interesting, all of them. As you saw, in all the cases, there was a very strong effect on the target strain that we were analyzing. So, as you know, Xylella fastidiosa has a huge diversity, genomic diversity, different subspecies, different sequence types. And even within the same subspecies and the same sequence type, we can find different behavior on the sensitivity of the different product. So that was seen for the bacteriophage, that as you saw, they choose an interesting approach using a subrogate host to select different phages. And not all of them were as effective against all the different strains that were tested. So that encouraged and give a very important result that dealing with Xylella is not an easy thing. So when we were approaching different control measures, we need to take into account the genetic diversity of the bacterium. Nevertheless, the results were very promising, and there are a few phages candidates to be tested further with more strains, and hopefully in the plants. Not in this project, but probably in the future with new projects. Also, we have the possibility to see how the olive microbiome within the saline vessels can be is changed according to different factors. The main factor was the environmental conditions that were rated by the different seasons. In spring and autumn, we could find different microbial composition. And also, when Xylella fastidiosa was present, we induced very strong changes in the microbial diversity. Indeed, the richness and the total bacteria were displaced. So Xylella was the main component of the total microbiome and displaced the rest of the bacterium. whereas the olive genotype seems to have a minor role. This is somehow discouraging because if we think that the bacterial microbiome or the fungal microbiome may have a role on the resistance of the different genotypes, so maybe we are not looking well what are the microorganisms involved on that, or is something more related to the reactions that this microbiota can induce on the plant, that also they can induce some different response mechanisms. Nevertheless, they have provided new insight on the what are the components of the xylem, the bacteria that, and the fungi that are present in the olive xylem, which one of them can be cultured, isolated and cultured. And maybe some of the isolated microorganisms that are specifically inhabitants of the xylem vessels can induce some good results reducing Xylella fastidiosa growth. Then we saw also how to look for different eco-friendly compounds of natural origins and also mineral elements. We have the interesting result that four different strains behave differently, so not all of them are susceptible or resistant or are inhibited for these products. That stresses again the need to have a broad range of strains when targeting Xylella fastidiosa, especially if you are in an area such as Spain or the Balearic Islands, or in France where you have more than one subspecies or more than one sequence type. Some of the products that were selected in vitro show also some interesting results on the plant, so they deserve to be studied further and see if the effect on the plant is it lasts during the growth of the plant on time. And finally, we also saw how the different free fatty acid and oscillins are modified by Xylella fastidiosa infection. We saw also that these compounds affect the lifestyle of the bacterium, so it can affect if the bacterium for more biofilm or it has more a planktonic growth style. And this is important because, as Pasquale mentioned, it can be related to the moment where the bacteria pass from one endophytic lifestyle to a more pathogenic lifestyle. Also, they form significant differences in the lipidomic composition when they compare infected and non-infected plants. That can also be a mark for detecting olive infected plants. I also encourage you again to have a look to the different posters. You can find there also other studies on the use of alternative compounds against Xylella fastidiosa and also other potential biocontrol agents, the search for them. Also some microbiome studies in which it is analyzed how the microbiome changes between healthy infected branches and also across the branch length from the older branches to the youngest one. Finally, I also want to mention the work done on the use of antimicrobial peptides, because some of them have shown some promising results inhibiting the bacterium. They have been also trying on plants. Also, again, good result has been found only for some plant species, but also not for all of the tested ones. And what is more important, some of the antimicrobial peptides can induce a reduction on the biofilm formation of the bacterium. So the mechanisms of all the products and all the tools that we are testing are incredibly high. So I think there is room for a new project also to It's a pity that the X factor finished now, so because there are now so many questions open, so many new lines to follow, that hopefully some of the groups that participate in the project or other groups participating at EFSA conference can continue developing. That's all from my side.
Just to say that I also think that these projects open new questions and open new initiatives. And I think it would be great if these questions unresolved have continuity for the next coming years, and to solve the control of and find ways to control the vectors and the disease itself, which are threatening all these new crops that are coming in and new risks associated to the Xylella fastidiosa.